Has come forward alleging a long-term affair with the married candidate.
Emma Thompson stars there as the wife of a presidential candidate in primary colors, starring John Travolta in the film version of the controversial bestseller. I'm Gene Siskel of the Chicago Tribune.
And I'm Roger Ebert of the Chicago Sun-Times. Primary Colors is the eagerly awaited new film by Mike Nichols starring John Travolta, based on the bestseller by Anonymous, who is actually Joe Klein, formerly of Newsweek, about the campaign adventures of a presidential candidate who obviously resembles Bill Clinton. The big news for me is this is a superb film. Primary Colors is the most knowledgeable and thoughtful mainstream political movie really of recent years.
I'm gonna tell the truth. I know what you're thinking. You're thinking he must really be desperate to do that, but if you had to swallow enough garbage.
You can say it, we're X-rated.
me too, if you believe what you read in the paper.
The movie offers a fascinating portrait of the candidate and his wife, played here by Emma Thompson, who is furious with him for missing an important appearance in the New Hampshire primary.
These people don't know you. They probably don't even remember your state. They're waiting to be swept off their feet by Orlando Ozio, who's the governor of a real state, but they came to meet you, and you didn't show. Mm-hmm. You know, I talked to the head of the Portsmouth Democratic Party about fly fishing for an hour and 45 minutes.
The movie is told from the point of view of a campaign worker named Henry, played by Adrian Lester, who gets swept up by the candidate's charisma. More realistic is the candidate's old friend Libby, played by Kathy Bates, who was brought on board to handle damage control.
We gotta stop them before they stop us. We gotta crush them and sweep them up. From now on, you can call me the Dustbuster. You know, honey child, I'm stronger than dirt.
I believe you.
Bates is wonderful in this movie. Funny, raucous, angry, and touching in an Oscar-caliber performance. By midway in the campaign, Henry is having an affair with another staff member, and a veteran political consultant is sharing their exhaustion.
You know, Henry, when this is all over, you and me ought to work together. Set up a consulting firm, tap that black Hotchkiss vote.
Oh, look, both of you, stop with the when this is over, we are pros. All right, maybe you're pros, but I've gotten emotionally involved.
Can I sleep here?
No.
That's Maura Tierney, and Billy Bob Thornton there was a Southern political pro who looks a whole lot like Clinton advisor James Carville. Primary Colors follows the broad outlines of Clinton's primary campaign, bimbo eruptions and all, but it's not simply a docudrama. It's an intelligent, perceptive film written by Elaine May and directed by Mike Nichols with real insight into human nature. And from John Travolta and Emma Thompson come two performances that could have been awkward or embarrassing, but are absolutely wonderful, self-assured, subtle, and convincing.
Oh, it's top-flight entertainment. But you know, the big story, of course, on this film has been that somehow it's been softened. And let me tell you something. If it has been softened, that doesn't mean it's soft. This is rough stuff. I was shocked. The language that is used between the two of those characters, I mean, words that are thrown at President Clinton, let's face it. I mean, you know, it's sophistry to suggest this is anybody but President Clinton. So the language that's used is shocking.
Oh, well, this movie hasn't been softened because I've read the book, you have too, and basically the book is here on the screen. What's also interesting is the way they really deal with ethical issues. With if you get some dirt, do you bring it out? Do you let somebody else bring it out? How do you handle it? Where do you draw the line?
Well,
it's really advanced and mature in its handling of those kinds of subjects.
That's because the subject is dirt.
Yes.
Really. Now, the film has a larger purpose, and that's what, you know, elevates it as a very special movie. And that is saying that we are consumed by dirt. That the public discourse is now about the cheapest material in these politicians' lives and issues. Forget. I mean, think about it. I'm just thinking through the picture. What issue is really discussed? There's something about, you know, who's going to cut Social Security, but it's not really dealt with.
It's all about personalities and secrets and gossip and tabloid journalism. And yet at the same time, oddly enough, I think the film basically will hurt President Clinton less than it will help him.
As long as you stated it, I completely disagree.
Well, I think this is going to hurt your lead since you started.
I think this is going to hurt him a lot.
I don't think so.
Okay, next movie, and our next film is Love and Death on Long Island, and this is a very strange film, and a good one, about a man who discovers a passion in a place where he least expects to. The man is a writer who lives in the fussy manner of a man of letters from the 19th century. He knows nothing about modern conveniences, but much to his surprise, and to those who know him, he finds something modern he cares about when he stumbles into a multiplex movie theater and walks into the wrong film, one called Hot Pants College 2. And is drawn to one of its male actors. So he goes to a video store for the first time in his literary life to rent some of the actors' other films.
That's Al.
I'm sorry.
Text Max. Went out an hour ago.
Really?
That's in. Harry! Skid marks.
Nah, tape's buggered.
That's John Hurt as the writer, and he travels to America to seek out the young actor he adores, played by Jason Priestley. And he meets with him and with his girlfriend, Fiona Lowy.
I'm talking about a type of acting that is purely instinctive. You see, Ronnie, you have something that gives even the most casual look or gesture a real intensity.
Now, I'm not exactly sure why Love and Death on Long Island works so well. I suspect, though, it's because any passion so well expressed as in this film is simply captivating and entertainment. The John Hurt character is an original. This is precisely, however, the kind of small picture that plays a couple of weeks in one theater in most cities and then disappears, and people wonder later how they missed it. You are warned. The title is Love and Death on Long Island.
And I got a letter from somebody saying who dies in the movie, but of course the character's name is Giles Dieth.
I know.
And it is a wonderful film. It's
sure.
a comedy, apart from anything else, although there's some poignancy and some
a lot of poignancy.
Insight in it. And the specific details of this character and the way that he doesn't understand anything at all
right.
about the 20th century
right.
and the way that he says in a lecture after falling in love with this kid in this terrible movie, he says, "You find beauty in the most unexpected places."
Well, that's
and
it.
That's exactly his whole training is
right.
looking for beauty, and he is open to find it, even in Hot Pants College too.
Yeah, it really is an you know, we don't use the word original more than once every couple of months on this show. This is an original.
Okay, later in the show, they took those giant IMAX cameras to the world's tallest mountain to film Everest. And coming up next, The Man in the Iron Mask, Leonardo DiCaprio's first film since Titanic.
You're constantly surrounded by beautiful women. Do you love any of them?
Quite frequently, actually. I am a young king. But I am king.
Then be a good king.
Leonardo DiCaprio, the star of Titanic, is back in a new role, a dual role in The Man in the Iron Mask. It's a historical swashbuckler that has a theory about the man in the mask. According to this film, he was the twin brother of Louis XIV, and, of course, knowledge of his existence would be a threat to the crown. That was Gabriel Byrne in the scene we just saw as D'Artagnan, the musketeer loyal to the king. The famous other three musketeers, however, think France would be better off if they replaced the man on the throne with the man in the Iron Mask.
I can assure
They're played by an all-star cast, Jeremy Irons, John Malkovich, and Gerard Depardieu.
Louis has an arrogance, a manner.
Which can be adopted.
And people close to him.
Do you imagine I've not considered that? That I have not considered everything?
Have you considered that it is not only our lives that you risk? It is Philippe's as well.
Meanwhile, Louis XIV is a ladies' man who makes the mistake of trying to seduce the intended bride of one of the musketeers' sons.
If you know that there is more of me to love than a crown,
the musketeers are discovered in the midst of their daring substitution and rally to the famous cry, "One for all for one." The Man in the Iron Mask gets off to a very shaky start, and only if you've read the book or seen the earlier movies will you really know who all the players are. The substitution plot is ingenious, although I doubt that Jeremy Irons is big enough to smuggle Leonardo DiCaprio out of prison under his cloak. And some of the scenes at the end have real power, though. But DiCaprio was not especially mesmerizing in this first post-Titanic role, and the Three Musketeers get lost in the twists of the plot. The standout in the cast is Gabriel Byrne, whose strong presence shows what the whole movie might have been like.
So you're not recommending
it?
No,
I'm not.
And I'm not recommending it either. And I think that plot dominates character here. Mm-hmm. I mean, it is an exceedingly complicated plot. At the same time, there aren't simply enough moments. You know, the story has been done before and done very well. It has also been broken out as a Musketeer's story, just mm-hmm. part of it. This is just too much story to the point that I noticed the swashbuckling more than I cared about the characters.
It wasn't organized. There wasn't an explanation from the beginning to the end that we could follow. In fact, the real story of the movie doesn't emerge until well into the first hour.
Yeah, disappointing.
Coming up next, a truly big screen film about climbing the tallest mountain. The IMAX film Everest is next.
To the middle camp, the wind was still very strong up above. We start to think we'll have to give up.
Climbing the world's tallest mountain, photographed like you have never seen before in the powerful experience simply called Everest, which was shot in the large film format called IMAX and is being shown in huge theaters with screens up to, in some instances, 8 stories high. And that large screen format is perfectly suited for this experience, which is to place us on the mountain amid blistering windstorms and blocks of ice and snow. We follow one climbing team, but because climbing the 29,000-foot Himalayan peak has increased in popularity, there are other climbers on the trail, and many of them have to be evacuated after they get into deadly trouble. In the wake of disaster, the movie's remarkably gifted climbing team has to decide whether they should push ahead or turn back.
We started to think about going up again, but a strong wind was still blowing a huge plume of snow off the summit, so it didn't look all that promising.
What is impossible for you to experience on your TV set is how effective this film Everest is when projected upon a towering curved screen, giving us a taste of the whiteout experience of being in the mountains of Nepal.
Up here, we really start to feel the lack of oxygen, and that's the biggest danger on Everest. The less oxygen your brain gets, the harder it is to think straight.
This film is very good in explaining the extreme oxygen stress that the climbers are put through. We're told your body needs to develop twice as many blood cells to store the oxygen you need to keep on climbing. So simply breathing and pushing ahead step by step is the necessary skill beyond any fancy mountaineering. And that was an eye-opener to learn that. Endurance is key to climbing Everest, but ultimately, Mount Everest itself is a star of the show as well. It should be in a very good 40-minute film opening this month on about 75 large format screens around the nation, typically in museums or other non-traditional venues.
Gene, I can't recommend it.
Wow.
I was reminded of Dr. Johnson's comment about a dog standing on its hind legs. It is not done well, but one is surprised to see it done at all. This is not a good documentary film. Werner Herzog made a much better film about the passion and the agony of mountain climbing, and also about the specific subject of being halfway up the mountain in contact with a friend higher up you can't reach who is dying. I think it's the dark glow of the mountain. As I was looking at this film, there were 5 or 6 shots looking straight down into a crevice, for example, that are spectacular. But always you have this nagging question. For example, the shot of the 2 people on the summit. They're not alone on the summit. There is a camera crew on the summit with them. What about the people who carried the camera up there and shot the movie? If the documentary had been about shooting the movie, it would have been more interesting. At the end, we get some pictures of some people who helped carry up the camera. It's, if you saw this in any other format than IMAX, you would say it was a very thin documentary that doesn't really explore these people. And so, in this case, the medium is the message.
Well, no, I felt that I got other messages, and you nodded in assent that it was, you know, helpful to learn about the physical stress involved in this. I mean, we know it's obviously stressful, but I'm mm-hmm. talking about the mechanics of it. Mm-hmm. I expected, and maybe you did too, that, you know, climbing it, you know, the scaling. We think there aren't shots of a lot of the scaling. There aren't any shots of the scaling of surfaces. On the contrary, it's plunging ahead. It's acclimatizing your body. Mm-hmm. And that was, and that's the essence, I think, of a good documentary.
But there is a whole genre of mountain climbing films that has better mountain climbing footage than this
one does. Only 40 minutes long. I'm sure there are better mountain climbing pictures
out there.
Most
of them are about that long.
Okay, when we come back, Jon Bon Jovi plays a Hollywood star who plays the leading man on screen and off.
Jon Bon Jovi is a Hollywood movie star who offers to seduce a famous playwright's wife as a favor for the playwright. As the movie opens, the playwright, played by Lambert Wilson, is having an affair with his leading lady, and his wife knows exactly what's going on.
I hate waiting around, not knowing when to start dinner.
Well, you know, casting sessions, there's no time.
I know how long casting sessions last. I've seen you through 11 plays. You didn't call because you were with her.
Meanwhile, at rehearsals, the Bon Jovi character meets the playwright's mistress, an actress played by Tandy Newton.
But don't try to impress him, either by being his equal.
Your father's no mere mortal. But then again, maybe there's his daughter.
Seeing that the playwright is trapped between his wife and his lover, the Hollywood star offers to solve everything by seducing the wife. The playwright is tempted, but is troubled by the implication.
I look at it as a compassionate way out. She's going to get to see that leaving you isn't the end of the world.
What would be in it for you?
There's going to be expenses along the way, but, you know, basically, I just see this as doing a favor for a friend. You know, I've seen her picture. She's a beautiful woman. This isn't going to exactly be a chore, you know.
The leading man goes a little haywire with goofy melodrama in its closing scenes, but up until then, it's an intriguing story with the kind of secret emotional deal-making that Hitchcock might have enjoyed filming. Jon Bon Jovi has been trying to launch a film career, and on the basis of this film, I think he can give up the day job if he wants to. And I like Lambert Wilson's torture performance as the husband who can't say no.
I can't recommend the film, Roger. I didn't, and you know, in this test, this old test, I just didn't care about these characters. The device seemed to me to be artificially laid on top of the situation. I don't think it's worthy of Hitchcock. He would have made it a much more malevolent
situation.
Well,
it kind of reminded me of Strangers on a Train, where somebody says, I'll do this for you, and you'll do something for me, and so forth.
But there, I felt no tension, as I did in Strangers on the Train. Coming up next, our revival spotlight falls on the theatrical reissue of the most popular movie musical since The Sound of Music. Grease is coming back to theaters.
Light is brought to you by Nestle Raisinets. At the movies or at home, Raisinets.
The American movie musical is pretty much dead, buried, it is said, because today's audiences will reject the moments when the characters stop talking and burst out into song. I've never believed that. I think it's the songs and the production numbers that count, and the good ones will always work. And the last truly successful movie musical proves that. Grease, John Travolta and Olivia Newton-John, first released 20 years ago in 1978, proving that with a hugely entertaining parade of high school love story songs, including the opening number with Danny and Sandy recalling their summer love.
I met a girl crazy for me.
Met a boy cute as can be.
Summer days drifting away to the summer nights.
To fit in with his buddies, Danny begins treating Sandy coolly. However, she still has strong feelings for him, as expressed in this wonderful song.
You know, I'm just a fool who's willing to sit around and wait for you. But baby, can't you see? There's nothing else for me to do. I'm hopelessly devoted to you.
Grease is one of the most enduring musicals of all time, with countless stage productions, and I prefer this film to any stage version I've seen. The movie theater revival of Grease with sparkling new prints begins nationwide on Friday, March 27th.
To my heart, I must be true.
Now let's recap the movies we reviewed on this show. Two thumbs up, way up, for the brutal, pointed political commentary of Mike Nichols' Primary Colors. The movie opens next Friday. Two thumbs up for Love and Death on Long Island with John Hurt and a wonderful characterization of a man of letters, falling in love with a movie actor. Two thumbs down for The Man in the Iron Mask, a disappointing treatment of the Alexandre Dumas novel. A split vote on Everest, the large format documentary, and another split vote on the leading man, John Dygan's Love Rectangle. Roger cared more about the characters than I did.
Okay, now playing in many cities is our one-hour pre-Oscar special of We Pick the Winners, where Gene and I reveal who we'd vote for at the Academy Awards. You can find it on this same local channel, and we're also listing all the stations and times on our website, Siskel-Ebert.com. You can also hear our reviews on that site. Next week, we'll be back with reviews of more new movies, including Wild Things, romantic thriller starring Kevin Bacon, Matt Dillon, and Neve Campbell.
Excuse me?
I mean, it's hard enough for one person to keep a secret, let alone three.
That's next week, and until then, the balcony is closed.